Parents of murderers, how do you view your son slash daughter now? Okay, I'll give you a teaser. My good friend's older brother brutally murdered their sister and parents. He told my friend that he had to in order to save the two brothers the devils told him. My friend was and is one of the sweetest lads to ever exist. His brother developed schizophrenia in his late teens and heard voices telling him to do awful things. Their parents tried so hard. Brother is in a facility for life. Friend still has the same shocked facial expression that he instantly adopted after losing his entire family. He is broken. All the moms in his neighborhood took care of him growing up, but the insurance and fostering could not give him back what he most wants. My son and daughter are both serial killers. Sometimes they even kill together. I'll let them get away with it because it brings them joy and it's their natural instinct. I occasionally find their kills all over the backyard or house, mostly lizards, mice, sometimes birds if they got lucky. I just wish they'd say something more to me besides meow meow. Obligatory not a parent and not murder. One day the FBI and Homeland Security show up at 6 a.m. to raid our house. They take my parents away to ask them questions and put my brother in a police car. I was left alone BC I was away at college when the crimes occurred. Find out our internet was being monitored for the past year and my brother had hard drives full of child porn and dog related porn. His age range was 13 to 15 year old girls, but the public attorney said there were also videos of babies being sexually assaulted. He also beat and sexually abused our beloved family dog and took videos of it on several occasions. My brother was older by 3 years, so I had known him my whole life, and I had no trouble letting him go. I was mortified by what he did. I did suffer PTSD after, and had horribly graphic nightmares about him chasing me down and beating me. My parents still love him, and visit him almost every weekend. He will be in prison for 20 years, they will be in their 70s, when he gets out. I think they blame it on mental illness. They buy him nice meals and load his commissary up constantly. I only go visit because I don't want to upset them as they've been through enough. My son seemed perfectly normal throughout childhood. He went and played soccer with the other kids, joined the swim team during the summers, and had good grades. But then something changed when he joined the cis site during college. I agree with his quest and helped him in eliminating the people who don't use serious tags when needed. So I'm not a parent of a murderer. I'm a child of a murderer. I'm currently 21 years old, and when I was 3 my mom was murdered by my father. Can I even call him father? More like a distant relative, and partly dismembered, and hid in a trash bag for 3 days before my grandpa, his dad, called the cops. My dad acted back quote normal in the days following. He drank beer, and watched football with the neighbors. I was raised by his parents all my life, and was taught growing up that he didn't take care of her properly as she had a lot of health and mental issues. So I accepted that. Like I didn't know that wasn't a thing. I googled my dad's name when I was 11 a week before Christmas. I didn't talk to him for a year. He only calls when he wants money from my grandma. I no longer have visitation rights since I turned 18, but could get it changed to let me see him, but I don't really want to TBH. My dad is a skilled artist, which is what I love to do. So I'm grateful for that, and the fact he passed it down to me. He also plays music very well. I've not got a natural ability, but can kinda play the violin with some practice. I don't plan on talking to him, if and when he gets out. If he even tries. I don't think he would. Unless it's for money. I used to dream of opening a tattoo shop with him as a little kid. I miss being young and not knowing the truth, but I'm glad that I found out and now I can't trust him. My aunt, who was psycho before all of it happened, became even more so when her son was convicted of murder. The evidence was overwhelming. My mom went into it not wanting to believe, but she knew he was guilty. Not my aunt. Nothing could convince her. She died believing he was innocent. He is not. Guilty as hell. She was a cruel woman. I would not be surprised if this did not help create the monster he became. I'm not a parent of a murderer, but I'm a sister of one. My brother is serving life in prison for 3 murders that he and his stepbrother committed. I wasn't born yet. I'm not really sure how I feel about him. I hate him, but I love him at the same time because we're family. My mom and dad don't acknowledge him whatsoever, and the only way I found out about him was when my mom caught me researching serial killers, because I wanted to catch them. She then told me about what happened, but I've never heard my dad speak his name, and I'm too afraid to bring him up to him. I went to high school with a guy who raped and killed some old lady. It's a crazy and long story, but he got into some trouble, got a lawyer who told him about a bunch of money, then promised she'd leave the country with him if he got it for her. The old lady was the only one between him and the cash. He raped her, then suffocated her with a plastic bag. Anyway, the family lost their fucking minds when he got the death penalty, and for a while I'd swing by their Facebook pages just to see what kind of stuff they'd post about it. It was always some Bible quote about forgiveness and love, or a poorly worded and structured rant about how fucked our courts are for killing such a young man. If it was up to his family, he'd be walking free and it would be like nothing happened. I'm casual friends with someone in my neighborhood that killed a guy in his teens. It was in self-defense, at least he told me so, but I think they both were into illegal activities, either drugs and or stealing, so the guy spent several years in juvie. It really messed him up, and he already came from a bad background. His brother was in an outlaw biker gang and was murdered, for instance. So this guy now is a meth addict with a myriad of health problems. Honestly, all of my interactions with him have been fine. I think if he just came from a stable family, he would've turned out way different. I worked in forensic care for a bit. People have committed a crime, but there is a background of mental illness. The relationship before the crime seems to be the most important factor, more than the details or nature of the crime itself. A lot of our patients were already estranged from their parents, history of abuse or neglect on a background of poverty, substance use, etc. For the patients who had good relationships with their parents, that relationship didn't seem to change. The parents would visit, bring them things, become involved in their care, advocate for them, offer support. Considering some of the crimes, I'd say they're the definition of unconditional love. I once shared a cab with Dylan Klebold's mom Sue, Columbine Killers. We were heading to a survivors of suicide education seminar. It's weird. We talked a bit, and I kept having to remind myself that a son murderer so many people then committed suicide. She wrote an interesting book about being his mom. Not the parent. Her uncle stabbed his sister to death. Her poor sons tried to intervene and had their mom die in their arms. He was put in life in a mental facility as he was spouting demons invaded her body, and he was doing Lord's work, or whatever. Mom kinda said he was off, never met him. Their mother, grandma's sister, is in denial, and doesn't really talk about his killing his sister. Some people don't agree she talks with him, visits him, and concerned of her son's well-being at the facility, but like if she cut him off she would lose two children. Most family aren't close to them, so he could very well be really mentally sick, and not faking it to avoid jail, that the family rumor mill likes to spew. I can't really blame her, it's all very reality shattering. Not a parent. My uncle by marriage is a jovial, pleasant man. My aunt is a good woman. Yes, I mean decades later, I found out he had been in prison prior to their marriage. He had money, but not a clearly discernible source, so expected it to be related. Nope. Was intoxicated, some guy of a different race said something, and he laid into him hard. The beaten man nearly died, don't know he didn't. So uncle went up for attempted murder. Hard to believe. He's always been a nice old man. Still is. Not a father, but my brother hears voices that told him to kill. I have no idea where he is. I know he's up in a prison somewhere for doing something. I'm pretty sure he killed someone. But yeah, me personally, I just distance myself from him mentally. I pretend he doesn't exist, and that I've never heard of him. Tell yourself these comforting lies enough, and you start to believe them. Not a parent, but a boy from my high school was raped by an older man when he was like around 6th grade. He didn't tell anyone. This all came out in the court case. He found out when he was like 17 that the same old man also raped his little brother. It was like a small neighborhood, the old man wasn't a stranger. Anyways, once he found out, he beat the old man to death with a hammer. People's opinions of him are mixed, but no one really thinks poorly of him. Opinions range from "damn, I'd do the same thing" to "I wish he could have got therapy" or something along those lines. I think what makes it hard for people is that it was done with a hammer. No one thinks, geez, what a psycho, but the violence is not lost on anyone. Other way around. My mom is in prison for life for murder. She was my best friend growing up, and I loved her so much. She wasn't convicted until 10 years after the murder, and I was ripped away from her by police and given to my estranged father at age 11. I've seen her once in prison since, and I don't know who she is anymore. I have love for her, but I don't understand how she could have done it and not think of the consequences, and how I would have gotten affected by her poor choices. I'm a young adult now, and it's been 8 years. I'm doing okay. I haven't contacted her since that visit. But I have trust issues from it though, knowing no matter how much I love someone, they can turn out to be not the person I thought. My dad was sexually abused by his brother. His family found out, but blamed my dad for seducing him because he was the scapegoat and they think his abuser shits gold. Nothing was done about it, and it's been swept under the rug. When I brought it up, my dad's family said it's under the blood of Christ. They are evangelical, not Catholic, mind you. Now, so I should just forgive and move on. I wonder if there are any more victims I don't know about, or if there are kids still being hurt by him. I've gone no contact with the whole lot of my dad's family save for my dad himself, so I have no clue. The whole thing fucked up my dad really bad. He's a raging homophobe and extremely paranoid. A college friend of mine's husband was busted for making and distributing child pornography. Another member of his family was busted along with him. The girls involved were very young. My friend was pregnant with their child, a daughter. My friend immediately left him and filed for divorce. His family would have nothing to do with her because she didn't stand by him. Her parents were so furious about what happened that they wouldn't travel to the States. They live in Europe for the birth, so only her sister and I were present. After the birth, she had a mental breakdown due to PPD and basically raising the kid alone. Her ex-in-laws got a lawyer and took the kid away from her. She completely dropped off the grid after that. She said she was going to live with her parents for a while and stopped talking to all of her friends from college. I haven't talked to her in years and can't locate her. None of my other friends can either. As far as I know, the child, she'd be a teenager by now, is still with her paternal grandparents, and her pedophile father sees her regularly. What a wonderful legal system we have. My father was a disgusting man who I'm glad got what he deserved. He abused everyone in my home mentally and physically, but I was the only one he raped. I developed early onset schizoaffective disorder and got quickly turned onto drugs afterwards. After my first suicide attempt, I finally confided to my mother and she immediately went to the police. He's in jail now, but I still want him dead. My grandfather attempted to be an axe murderer to kill my dad, but didn't succeed. My father broke the cycle and never did more than spank me maybe twice in my life when I was a complete shit. My friend's father, I'm pretty sure, abused him. He made me hide in the closet during a sleepover once randomly cause his dad was coming into the room. I found out from my mom a few years ago that that guy got locked up for being a kiddie diddler, so I imagine he wasn't able to break that cycle. The sex abuse in my family is generational. I'm confident my father was sexually abused because his mother sexually abused me and my sister, and I know my mom was also molested because she told me about her uncle who abused her. In my mom's case, it was swept under the rug, and I think that's a large part as to why she turned a blind eye to what happened to me and my sister. My dad sexually abused us, as well as emotionally, physically, and psychologically. My sister also sexually abused me. Because the trauma started at such a young age, I developed dissociative identity disorder. It's comorbid with PTSD, depression, and anxiety. I never really came to terms with the abuse until about 1 year ago. I'm now 30. I mean, I remember things like my dad watching Japanese torture porn with me in the room, but it didn't click that things like that aren't normal until I was in my late 20s. That's the problem with growing up in abusive homes. Really fucked shit just seems normal. So you don't think you're being abused, you just think this is what life is. It also didn't help that the did caused events to be fractured across altars. So in one identity state I can remember what happened, but I don't feel anything about it, but in another identity state I become horrified and sick to my stomach when I smell Camel cigarettes. However, I didn't know why until I came to see the other alter's memory. As for what's happened to my abusers, well, my grandma died alone in the hospital, which was more than she deserved. My father has drunk himself into having brain damage and is working on killing himself in the bottom of a bottle. My sister has finally been able to get clean after 20 plus years of drug abuse, self-medication. She is working on her mental health, and it's going to be a long road for her, but I'm happy she might actually end up okay. I don't hold anything against her since, given the situation, I really don't know how else she could have handled what was happening to her. As for myself, I have all the classic symptoms of a CSA survivor. I started having sex at a young age, have mental health issues, chronic physical health conditions, etc. I was suicidal constantly between the ages 8 to 12, 30, but I don't want to die anymore. I'm happy, and I've broken the cycle of abuse. I'm married to a wonderful man, and at a good university studying something I love. My life is a group project, and we are working hard to find a cohesive system of coordination. We feel that things look good,